Good evening, you're watching Trending Tonight with me, Sanket Upadhyay. Two stories that we are tracking as of this moment. There is a political story and also there is a very, very important story as far as coronavirus is concerned. The political story first. A captain versus Sidhu battle is going on, not just in Punjab, but in the national capital also for a very long time. After that interview of Navjot Singh Sidhu with NDTV, where he said that I have been reduced to a showpiece. Captain Amrinder Singh is explaining himself, trying to build his case. Who will win? What will happen? Right now, the party has made it clear that there cannot be a change of guard as of this moment. So the party will go into the elections with Captain Amrinder Singh as the face. But more importantly, in the long run, and that's the question that we are asking, who is making a compelling case to the high command? And will the high command listen to the person making the compelling case? Story number two, there is a new concern in India. And this concern has to be understood. This is a variant which is being called the variant of concern now by the Indian government. We want to understand what is the Delta Plus variant. Now remember, there was a Delta variant which is still wreaking havoc across the world. It did so in the second wave in India. But Delta Plus, a little more than Delta, what exactly are the challenges? And as the government says, and many experts in the government say, that if not contained and controlled by various means, this could possibly trigger a third wave, this Delta Plus variant. We have to understand what this variant is and what needs to be done. Lots of unanswered questions. But first, let's talk about Punjab, the political story. We have our guest with us this evening, Charan Singh Sapra, spokesperson of the Congress Party. We have Mr. Grewal with us, spokesperson of Punjab Aam Aadmi Party, as well as Mahesh Inder Grewal, spokesperson of the Shiromani Akali Dal. Ahbab Singh Grewal is with us. Thank you very much to all of you for joining us. We'll begin with you first, Mr. Sapra. We had an interview with Navjot Singh Sidhu yesterday. We're going to play excerpts of that in just a short moment, where he says that I have been reduced to a showpiece. In fact, what we can do is, before I ask you this question, let's actually play out that interview where he thinks that you have reduced him and his appearance to a showpiece.
When only 7 and 8 months are left, the system wakes up and says, Sidhu sir, come for tea. Hang on, Surkhab ke par lag gaye Navjot Sidhu ke, kya ho gaya? Chai. What sir? Are, come into the cabinet, have these words. I said no. 3 mahine baad, lunch, election aayega, ab Sidhu campaign karega. Sidhu campaign karega, uske baad mining hogi, ye hoga, wo hoga, falana hoga, aur Sidhu ko ek showpiece bana ke saja diya jayega. Here lies the question, your question. This background was necessary to answer it. Phir showpiece bana ke usko saja diya jayega.
Mr. Sapra, so now you realize that he feels that he will be used extensively for campaigning and then will be kept in one shelf as a showpiece. Now here lies a fundamental question. Is Mr. Sidhu's worth only that of a campaigner and nothing else in the Congress party?
See, Sanket, let me tell you that whatever Mr. Sidhu has said on your channel, definitely he must have said the same thing to the 3-member panel who has taken a detailed report on Punjab. Let me tell you, it is not only Sidhu whom this panel of senior Congress leaders has met. It is nearly 70 MLAs and maybe ministers and also so many senior Congress leaders whom the panel members have met. Shri Rahul Gandhi has independently met some of them today also. So, in a way, I wish to say that Congress party is concerned about Punjab, the situation in Punjab, and definitely a mechanism will be worked out whereby there will be a win-win situation and Congress party will emerge more stronger and a united face in Punjab. We have been resolving the issues.
How will that happen? Mr. Sapra, if you've got a leader who's saying that he's unhappy with the way things are going on, in an election year, by the way, last year around this time, not even around this time, last year, when the farmer agitation started, it was largely believed that the Congress party would have made a compelling case with the farmers and will come back to power. But now, 6 months later, look at what the situation is. Do you think that this volatility will give advantage to your opponents? For instance, the Aam Aadmi Party or the Shiromani Akali Dal?
No, Sanket, this volatility will settle down. That's what I'm trying to say. And the elections will be contested purely on the issues of Punjab, the farmers' education, and many more issues. Let me bring an issue to your notice that today itself the Punjab government has taken a decision about the slums. They are going to give ownership to these slum owners. There are various such decisions, you know, pertaining to education, pertaining to transport, pertaining to...
No, Mr. Sapra, you know, sorry to cut you short here, but see, the problem remains about a command conundrum, a leadership crisis. This is a problem which always exists, whether... And again, not just with the Congress. We see this with other political parties, but particularly with the Congress. Indecision has been a major issue, whether it is Rajasthan, and this is not me saying, your own leaders are saying, whether it is Punjab. Mr. Garewal of the Shiromani Akali Dal, you tell me politically, what does this mean? Do you look at this as an opportunity for yourself? Mahesh Inder Garewal, if you can hear me, I want to ask you, how do you look at this?
Sanket, it's not clear.
Can you hear me now? Okay, we'll fix
it. Yes, it's
yes.
Not clear.
Mr. Mahesh Inder Garewal, I want to ask you that politically speaking, what do you think could be the impact of this in the upcoming elections? Are you hopeful that this will help you?
It may help anybody, but it is destroying the Punjab. Punjab is facing many problems, farmers' agitation, corona lockdown, then there is a slump in the market. Then there is a strikes of the employees on the roads, unemployed, people are on the roads, the economy is shatters, the government is not in a position to pay off its employees, the arrears which they have decided. In that situation, Mr. Sidhu created a situation which has put further created problems for the state of Punjab. It's not a fight for principles, it's a fight for personal power. A simple thing is what Mr. Sidhu was doing for 4.5 years. Unfortunately, Sanket, the problem is that even during Gyani Zail Singh regime, when Gyani Zail Singh and Darbara Singh had tiff, Punjab faced violence, terrorism. When the Congress people are in fight against each other, then they make the issues emotional.
Well, that's
issues.
A very serious charge. So you're saying that volatility within the Congress will lead to...
Yes.
A sectarian rift.
Mr. Sidhu, the day he started firing at Captain, a month before he had a tea with him, he had a lunch with him, and he said he's like my father figure, so was said by Mrs. Navjot Kaur Sidhu. And then he makes a statement that Captain failed to deliver in the cases of sacrilege. See, it's a failure of Sidhu, it's a failure of Congress government.
Okay. Ahbab Singh Garewal, I want to come to you now. Ahbab Singh Garewal, I want to come to you now. See, the point is, there are two things at play here. Number one, that there is anger against Captain Amrinder Singh's style of governance, right? And number two, is this personality called Navjot Singh Sidhu? Do you think that within the Congress, there is this confusion? For instance, why has Mr. Sidhu become the face of this resentment against Captain Amrinder Singh? How do you look at this situation?
Mr. Upadhyay, the fact remains that Punjab has had no governance whatsoever. Whatever Mr. Sidhu is saying, whatever he is saying, that there are mafias prevalent, that whatever he says, that 70-30, that whatever mafias were prevalent during the Akali Dal period are still carrying on full scale right now, that's a fact. Every child in Punjab knows that. The fact is that I have one simple question for Mr. Sidhu and then for Mr. Maheshinder, that if Mr. Sidhu is made head of PPCC tomorrow or he's declared the deputy chief minister tomorrow, will everything go away? Will he be perfectly all right? If, as Mr. Garewal brought up history, he said that when there was trouble between Congress chief ministers or Congress ministers in the center and the state, there was always trouble in Punjab. The Nirankari problem in Punjab happened when Mr. Badal was the chief minister. The Dera Sacha Sauda problem happened in Punjab when Mr. Badal was the chief minister. Unfortunately, nobody has talked about governance in Punjab. In Punjab, it was either about one Dera or the other, or it was about waters, or it was about mafias. Nobody has bothered to talk about the governance in Punjab, and that's the sole reason that all Punjabis want to send their children away, is that Punjab has no future for them. And that's what these two parties have brought us to.
Okay, so let's just see what the Congress High Command, this panel, this empowered group, what decision do they eventually take? And can the Congress put its own house in order in Punjab? Thank you very much to the three gentlemen. Now let's talk about the other big story of concern, which is a variant of concern called the Delta Plus. And to understand this closely, I want to introduce Dr. Rahul Pandit. He's a member of the National Task Force he's a member of the National Task Force appointed by the SC, and also a member of the Maharashtra COVID Task Force. We also have with us Dr. S.K. Sareen, Director of ILBS. Thank you very much. You are also a member of the National Task Force. I'll come to you first, Dr. Pandit, because it seems to be that Maharashtra is the epicenter, or at least the beginning point, for most of these variants. Even the Delta variant started first, or was detected first, in Maharashtra. Can you share with us your experiences on how deadly this new Delta Plus variant is, and how much should we be worried?
Good evening, Sanket, and good evening, Dr. Sareen. Clinically speaking, I have actually not looked after a patient of Delta Plus variant myself. So what I have is information about how these patients are, and we found around 9 of them in Ratnagiri district, which is one district out there, and we've got around 21 or 22 reported across the 3 states in India. And from my clinical concerns, the major concern would be that, is there a symptomology which is different? Is there an infectivity which is different? Is there a virulence, means is it going to cause more severe infection than what one would be experienced with just the Delta variant, which we already know is the major variant right now? And of course, then comes the question about treatment efficacy and the vaccine efficacy. So from the symptom wise, I think it is causing more conjunctivitis, sore throat, a little bit of prolonged taste loss and smell loss. But we only have 22 patients to look at, and the symptoms are not very clear. So I think it's too early to actually detect. What we are doing is we want to detect more and more of these samples if we can. So we're increasing the genome testing in the districts of concern, so that we understand where we are in terms of clinically, as well as the spread which is happening. And that's where we are currently, Sanket. I think at the moment we know that apart from India, 8 or 9 other countries have shown this type of a variant. And the concern is that if it is happening at a receptor binding site on the virus, which is where the mutation is happening, then it may actually increase the binding into the lungs, and that may cause a severe form of infection. That is where the concern is. But whether it is true or not remains to be seen.
Okay, Dr. Sareen, you know, these points that Dr. Pandit mentioned are very important, that as far as the new variant is concerned, number one, we all know that the virus is going to mutate and there will be variants. So that is no rocket science, that everybody knows. But the key factors here to study are, what symptoms does it have? What is its virulence? That means how fast does it spread? And third, and the most important, Dr. Sareen, which is also going to be my question to you, the impact as far as vaccination is concerned. See, we have launched a massive vaccination drive. How soon can we be in a position to know whether this new variant cheats the vaccination, or is present vaccination still working?
Well, thank you, Sanket, and good evening, Dr. Rahul. The third question is very important in this sense. I would like to summarize. Today, we have entered into an era of genomic surveillance. Like we used to do biosurveillance, we need to do genomic surveillance. And this has to remain in force for a very long time in the country. We will keep seeing these variants, mutants coming. So this biosurveillance, genomic surveillance, will be a continuous effort by all of us and should be done. Coming back to the virus, One data we will need for every kind of mutation, that this is a new kind of a virus and what is the symptomatology. Like Delta, when it came, the people were taking longer to clear. You would have seen 3 weeks, 4 weeks, the patients are in the hospital and still are positive. So longer virus persistence, the delayed resolution, more severe disease and more lung injury and cytokine storms. Also stomach, also diarrhea. Also these patients after getting recovery had severe asthenia, weaknesses. So these were the different parts of the Delta. Now Delta plus, maybe very few cases are known, but it has spread so fast. So it is very possible that this can cause a third wave. Now, whether the vaccine will be effective or not, even for Delta, we have our own data of a large series of subjects, that the vaccine that we are giving today may not be as effective as far as preventing the infection. So you get two dosages, but you still can get infected. You can still have fever, you can still have myalgia, but the disease is not serious. It is not a severe COVID, but the infection cannot be totally protected. So whether the plus can break through our immune system, very likely. All these viruses survive by immune escape. They will try your body to be fooled and they want to multiply in your body. So there is a constant fear that these viruses will break through the immunity that you have, maybe the immunity the vaccine will have, and therefore we have to move to the next step. Do we need boosters? Do we need booster of a different kind? And such trials must initiate very rapidly. So I think we are in troubled waters again, and as the US now has 10% of Delta variant, and they say by August this will be the number one variant in the US. This is the prediction from the US. Just by August. So 3 months, the US will have Delta variant as number one. So maybe by 3 months, 2.5 months, we may have Delta plus or other variants as.
Yes, and variant. That is why, Dr. Pandit, you know, doctors like Dr. Guleria warning that we have to follow COVID appropriate protocol and behavior so as to avoid a third wave, which could in fact come as soon as 6 to 8 weeks. My only point is, having seen this deadly nature of the second wave, clearly time is not on our side. So what can be done? I mean, this is exactly how the Delta variant also started, right? Way before, much before the wave spread all over the country, we saw these few cases in Amravati and nearby areas. What can we learn from experience?
So I think we need to, so what one of the first things which we are doing now is we are actually doing genome surveillance of 100 samples from each district every month. So that's what's happening in Maharashtra. I think that needs to spread across the country. We may need to actually increase the genome sequencing and surveillance in the districts where the cases have been very high. Secondly, I think the double masking is the way. There is no other shortcut right now. Double masking is the way. Third and most important thing, like we've ramped up our vaccination drive the last 2 days, we have to have a targeted vaccination in districts where this is essentially putting its head up. And if we have to really beat the virus, we have to ramp up the vaccination so rapidly that if we can vaccinate our country within the next 3 to 4 months, we will not give that much of chance for it to mutate further and to spread further. Now, these are some of the broad strategies. If the ground strategies would involve, of course, micro-containing and putting these clusters where they are found. So, for example, Ratnagiri into a isolation zone right now, containment zone right now, and try and do maximum testing there and isolate the contacts as well as treat the contacts as well as the patients. So, this would be at the ground level which we will have to do. So it's going to be a multi-pronged approach. There's not going to be one approach. But for a common man, double mask is still the best
approach. What's the time frame you're looking at for us to be able to execute all of this?
I think we need to be as fast as possible. We cannot be complacent this time. I think we have to do it within the next 2 to 4 weeks. We have to actually do all of this in the next 2 to 4 weeks in the ground level where the variants are found. And for the country to vaccinate as fast as possible, I think certainly December seems to be too far for me, but I don't know whether we'll be able to achieve that or not.
Dr. Sarin, I mean, you know, many would say that this is This is a very alarmist side, you know, and also a point of concern being raised by doctors. But the point is, what do you do? We have seen what havoc the Delta variant has wreaked in our country simply because we were not serious enough or we did not take the cue. And right now, when Dr. Pandit says that our response should be in 2 to 4 weeks, Do you adhere to this timeline?
Well, I think it is. Yeah, I agree with him. In case we can do it, and I think India can do it if you want to vaccinate fast. Like we have done 84, 85 lakhs in a day. If you go to 1 crore or more than that in a day, I think we can achieve before the festive season comes, which can be still scary. So let us put a target of September 30th that we can vaccinate most of the country, maybe 80%. And with that, if we can get the vaccine and the people are there to vaccinate, that is a very, very important milestone which we have to try to achieve. But what is also important is that people should know when to open the lockdown. You did lockdown in multiple states, but one state opens, other state doesn't open, then there is a transmission. I think there should be clearly a policy, a planning that how to open the lockdown and the people movement from one state to the other is strictly prohibited for some time. Like people from Maharashtra, of course they will be moving and the Delta Plus will keep on moving like. So I think that has to be thought of at a larger issue.
That's a very important point. Because right now I think there is this desire that everybody has to unlock, and rightfully so, because you know, there's a life versus livelihood balance that one has to undergo. You see cases coming down and thus you unlock. But can we afford to unlock at this rate is the big question. Dr. Pandit as well as Dr. Sareen, thank you very much for raising these points of concern. We have to learn our lesson if we haven't already, seeing the experience with the Delta variant. A new variant is in town. It's called Delta Plus. Let's take a look now at this explainer prepared by our team.
21 COVID cases have many officials on the edge in Maharashtra because they have the Delta Plus variant, which is seen to be more infectious. They're now investigating where these 21 people traveled, whom they visited, anything to learn more about this. Health experts in Maharashtra fear the new mutated variant could potentially trigger the third wave.
It is worrisome because we don't know enough about how it is going to behave from here. We know that the Delta wave in other parts of the world is very infectious. It spreads very rapidly, and that it can affect a multitude of people within a very short period of time. So all those factors are different from the first wave.
The Union Health Ministry is now calling the Delta Plus variant a variant of concern. Like the Delta variant, it is also considered highly infectious with a higher transmissibility. It may show resistance to existing treatment protocol for COVID. There are also concerns over efficacy of vaccines against the Delta Plus variant.
Broadly speaking, let me tell you that both the Indian vaccines, which we are currently using in COVID vaccination program, we are using 3, but Sputnik V came much later. So Covishield and Covaxin, both are effective against Delta variant. But to what extent and what is the proportion of antibody titers that they produce, that information we would very shortly be sharing with you.
While rapid transmission of Delta Plus variant has not yet been reported in India, its behavior in other countries is a matter of concern for India too. And right now, health experts are closely observing how it behaves.
Health experts say the prevalence of this new variant of the virus is currently low.
The Brihanmumbai Municipal Corporation says it's already preparing its machinery for the predicted third wave, especially with the discovery of the Delta Plus variant of the coronavirus in Maharashtra. Municipal Corporation says that it's also looking at creating a more robust system of sharing real-time information in a situation where the virus spreads rapidly and there's pressure on the healthcare system. With Sukirti Divedi in New Delhi, in Mumbai, Saurabh Gupta, NDTV.